waterfalls. Simple waterfalls in the background. It's in Cherokee.
Oh.
It's kind of cool.
That's my boy.
See? Well, as many of y'all may know, my name is Mari Sanderson Jr.
We
work together as a team. And I have the top bunk bed. You met my sister earlier today.
Oh, cool.
But I want to talk about, just touch on a subject that he talked about in class about DNA. I'm fascinated by DNA. In particular, when Professor Sanderson mentioned that of all the people that have ever existed in this entire universe, there's no one else that would have my exact specific code. So as far as I'm concerned, I'm the most unique thing that's ever been brought up in this universe. Thank you. See?
Hey, you're welcome.
No, you heard it from him.
Actually, so.
Oh, shoot. You get to get it. Which is the whole point of what I'm talking about. First off, what is DNA? That's what we're going to talk about. We're going to talk about DNA, we're going to talk about genealogy, and we're going to talk about genealogy
That's
as a
big
business.
Slide, Morty.
Yeah, I'll keep it rolling.
You make a piece of paper look like.
But what is DNA? DNA, this little example shows. The thread-like chain of nucleotides carrying your genetic code. In other words, it's your entire makeup is encompassed within these ACTG molecules. Who discovered it? Because I know that's probably something that's top on your mind. Only in your lifetime, 1953. Before?
A little bit. I was born in 57, so
Before you showed up.
Just before I showed up.
Someone drew you out on paper, man, and they said this is what he's going to look like on their DNA sequence between these three people, Crick Watson and Franklin.
Where are they from?
You know what? They went to they were in Cambridge, so they could have been from anywhere, Europe or any kind of.
Crick was English. Rosalind Franklin and Tom and. And Watson were both American. Yeah.
See, there you go. But then again, we're talking about DNA, so they could have been from Brooklyn.
Oh.
Why is it important? It's important because it's inheritance. You receive all your information from your parents, your parents' parents, and all the way down to people that you would never even know about. Whether you believe that we came from chimpanzees, or if you
Which
believe
we didn't.
In God, where you came from, whether you came from a rib, or whether you believe that we came from aliens, we all pretty much originated in the same place, and through these different genetic codes is how you're made up. So in other words, you're only created because you have genes from your mom and from your dad. Unless you get them, even if you got them from a petri dish, they come from a male and female. Genealogy itself is the study of genes. Not genes, is the study of your family of lineage, where you come from. Genealogy in life has been passed on through oral stories, sitting around a campfire telling stories, grandfather talking to grandkids, grandmother talking to the kids, just passing down oral histories. Court records, documents are ways that you can also go find out about genealogy. Ellis Island is one of the most famed genealogy resources. People go back there to find out where they came from on those different ships. Many families in rural communities were not as fortunate to have birth records and wedding records. This is back when you had heavy industrialization, you had farming, had people popping out babies, they just didn't keep records. In particular, because we live in a country that did have slavery, slave owners and slaves didn't necessarily keep birth records or marriage records when they were transplanted through different plantations and all that kind of stuff. Another thing is Bibles. I know at our family home, we have a Bible. In the back of the Bible, you open it up, and it has pretty much a long dated history of our family, my own father's side. They can go clear back to 3-4 different generations in this particular community right there in the Bible. As a side note, the Church of Jesus Christ Latter-day Saints, LDS, are very good at genealogy, in case you did not know that. And they're very good at when you get like fruits, when you put them in jars, what's that called? Where you take jars, canning. They're very good at that. They keep stores of stuff for emergencies. So trust me about that. My own genealogy. I don't know my own genealogy. I can trace back roots from my mom's side of the family, from Myrtle Beach to Florence, South Carolina, to Timminsville, and then no one knows before
that. I was about to say from Myrtle Beach to Haiti, but
hey, never know, man. See, that's what I'm talking about, genes. But with that being said, on my father's side, they've kept better records. My father goes, my stepfather, I don't know my biological father, but my stepfather, they kept pretty good records. They're from the east coast of North Carolina. If you ever heard a town called Ahoskie, right now, if you just drove 5 hours east, that's where you would find it. They have farmland there, about 180 acres of farm was taken care of by my grandfather, who was a sharecropper, so there was a bunch of people in the community that did all that kind of stuff. I remember growing up eating strawberries and all that kind of stuff, never thinking twice about when I had to be home because I was out in the field. Doing that kind of stuff. On Mars Hill, on the Mars Hill College campus, there's a swimming pool there. It's called Pharrell Pool. My dad's maternal name is Pharrell, so we could be related. Where they're from is a town called Harrellsville, so I imagine that has something to do with, you know, our family ties. Genealogy as a business. Have any of y'all ever had your DNA tested to find out where you're from?
You're from Africa.
Where are you from?
No Spain.
No, oh yeah? All right, I'll take Spain too. But as a business, in the beginning when these guys first started, I have to imagine that when they started doing this, they had no idea that they would find something as groundbreaking as what they did. And then I can't imagine that they would have imagined 23andMe and all these other different things that people use. Now, on one aspect, I can imagine that you could understand a lot of medical implications that can come out of understanding DNA. But then on the other hand, you can understand the nefarious things that could also come out of DNA, which is what I'm talking about. I'm torn about the DNA ideas. On one side, the social side of me says it would be great to know where all that kind of stuff comes from. But the confrontational side of me says, why on earth are you giving the one thing away in your whole life that they need a court order for? So with that, I say proceed with caution. We live in an environment where everyone shares information, period. You have your cell phone, you're sharing information, that data, that's metadata, all these little tiny little bricks. Someone figured out that they can take this little thing and link you to me through like 50,000 people, and now they know who all our friends and our associates and families are. I understand that. I appreciate it. But at the same time, the social aspect of Facebook puts you in a position to be manipulated. Facebook founders wrote an article. They did an experiment. And in this experiment, it's called Facebook Manipulated More Than This. This is the article. Facebook manipulated more than 600,000 users' news feeds to study people's emotions. That was in 2014. They published a paper. This is a scientific paper. It's called Experimental Evidence of Massive Scale Emotional Contagion Through Social Networks. Someone on purpose changed your news feed to see how you would respond and then how your friends would respond, and they categorically put it in a report that said, this is what happens if you do this.
You have Facebook?
No. The significance. We show via a massive experiment, which is this is numbered, the N-naught, on Facebook that emotional states can be transferred to others via emotional contagion, leading people to experience the same emotions without their awareness. We provide experimental evidence that emotional contagion occurs without direct interaction between people. Exposure to a friend expressing an emotion is sufficient. So for someone to click like is enough to make you change your behavior. And in the complete absence of nonverbal cues. Familial DNA is the idea that I have brothers and I have sisters, and our DNAs are pretty much generally the same with the exception of a few changes, but you can tell that we came from the same family. I first heard about familial DNA a couple years ago when Nancy Grace was interviewing a guy up in New York. His daughter died. She was jogging. They showed a video of her. It was really a cool video where this was the last video of this girl. She's jogging by. You see her jogging, enjoying her life, and then the next thing you know, she's dead. So what happened was when they started doing investigations, they didn't have any leads. That was the only lead that they had, was a video just running right by, and then they found her in the woods. She was dead. Some smart person went to a DNA database and they threw in some DNA and said, hey, let's go see if we can find someone in this database. They went through this database and they pulled someone out and said, this is the guy that committed the crime. And in the news right now, if you're familiar with it, the guy called the Golden State Killer in California.
He's already 90 years old.
That's not the point. He could be 158 years old. The point is that someone in his family went to this DNA website. It's called GET database. It's a database of DNA. So if you want to, you want to go find out, oh, where did that come from? Where did that come from? All that kind of stuff. You submit your information. They put it in a database. Law enforcement came in. They went away, found, got some kind of tip from him. They probably got some cigarette butt. They went to this database. They threw the cigarette butt in, and out came smoke. And they said, this is the guy that did it. Now, I know what you're thinking. If you don't have anything to hide, you shouldn't run from cops. I know that feeling, because I felt that same way when I was in your shoes as a young person. I don't feel that way anymore. In New York, there's this concept called stop and frisk. You ever heard of it? Stop and frisk is a law that was, I don't know who created it, but I'm just familiar with it because I've traveled to New York and my friends told me to be careful when I go to certain places because I'll get stopped by police. I said, why would I get stopped by police? I'm just enjoying walking and living my life. They said, no, it's called stop and frisk. They can just stop you just to talk to you for no reason. You mean this guy can impede my freedom just to stop me and talk to me and harass me and all that kind of stuff? Because yeah. Nearly a million people. Between 2003 and 2013, over 100,000 stops were made per year, with nearly a million people being stopped at the height of the program in 2011. And they weren't finding like maybe 1%, 2% of crimes. So here you are living your life and you're stopped for no reason. Imagine that someone stopped and frisked your DNA. Imagine that someone stopped and frisked. Let's say I own an insurance company, right? And you have cancer, and you submit your information to the database. Then your sister comes along and she submits it. I see that you're family, and I decide that I'm not gonna cover your whatever your ailment is because you have a predisposition for it because it shows up in your family. I don't know that it's happened yet, but anytime that you take your information and store it in a database, someone is waiting, they're gnawing at the bits so that they can go in and get that information so that they can use it. 4 days ago, the US government sent out a blast saying, hey, we want a million people to come and be a part of this database. so that they can get research on genetics and medical. We have all this great stuff. We're going to solve all kinds of medical issues because now we can have a roadmap of how we can cure people. But really, think about that. I mean, what happened? You gave all your information to Facebook. That was just information. They put it in a report. KGB got the report and said, okay, this is what we can do to manipulate their social structure. All we have to do is say Hillary Clinton with this, jail Hillary Clinton, Trump is the man, and we can get our own guy into the office. It is literally that simple. And for that very reason, I did have Facebook. I did not set that up. In my personal life, I would never do that. But for business reasons, people say you need to have Facebook. You need to have Twitter. You need to have some. I was exhausted. I said, there's LinkedIn, there's all these things. How do you have time? How do you have time to live your life if every minute of your life you're thumbing and scrolling through some crap? You just don't have time for it.
Just don't talk
about
Facebook.
Yeah, well, see, you should argue why you should do it. And for that very reason, I understand. That's why I'm torn. Because I have friends that I've linked up with that I haven't seen since I was like in kindergarten. But at the same time, why do I need to put my information, give it to Zuckerberg? He's making money off it, giving it to Cambridge Analytics, and they're changing people's perspectives and ideas. You have all these ideas going on in your head. You don't even know why. And they will never be able to stop it. The internet, Google searches know what these words are. Because those are words that are in a bracket that say these are words. They search, if you look or stop and frisk specifically, you will come to my webpage.
Wait, can you send this PowerPoint to Moodle?
It's on my website. That's what I'm trying to tell you. MarioOsborne.com. Facebook and the internet will never know what this video is. It's just an object. So when people post pictures and whatnot on Facebook, all it sees is this picture. So no matter what they do, the only way that you can get rid of this picture and know that there's something vile in it is if someone sees it and reports it. They can't put in "find Dr. Ruth Ballard" unless someone specifically writes here a word that says Dr. Ruth Ballard. Do you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So if there's something in here that's completely wrong or something that's a lie or completely false, once you've already seen it, it's in your mind. They already know that. They proved it. Facebook in of itself proved that once you see this picture and it goes into your mind, you're going to respond to it and go talk to your friends about it. Even if you never click on it and go see the details of what the story is about. So, I say all that to say this. For as much as I appreciate and understand that people have this yearning to know where they've come from and all those kinds of things, I felt that. I think it's the coolest thing that I can send a drop of blood somewhere and someone tells me that 26 other individuals with a strong genetic theme from this place, that this might be where you're from. I really do think that's very cool. But at the same time, I know that governments, when you give information, they will misuse it as a tool, and you won't even know about it until it's too late. It's definitely come a long way since Click Watson and Franklin were doodling and doing what they were getting done. I think it's phenomenal. But the one side of me says, I love it, but then the other side of me says, you should keep the DNA to yourself because it's the only thing keeping you from being somebody else. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark.
You should get some DNA.
No, you can't go. You're not taking any questions.
Yeah, go ahead. What you got?
There you go.
What you got?
No, talking about Facebook. Sometimes my cousin posts some picture on Facebook, but they do not give me the option to say, I hate that picture. I put like. It's not people are liking, because I hate that picture. Yeah, sometimes people lack a teacher. It's not because they lack it.
But see, the very
they
fact.
They lack all the other option.
The very fact so you that say, you see. Here's the thing: when you have only yes or no, you create a bias, and so that bias shows up not only in your Facebook postings, but even if you look at the news media, Fox News, CNN News, like there's no in between medium. There's either yes or there's no. There's like or dislike.
Then you have all the studies looking at in your Facebook the news that you receive. Is catered to your position. So you never see any of the opposite sides.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, like the community Haitian in Alabama send me a text. They say, do you want to meet with me? And I say, meet with me? Because my Facebook say I'm leaving Alabama. Mm-hmm. So they send me, they want to meet
with me. You mean you put fake news in your...
This is not fake news. So you... By the way, I'm working for the government. So I'm going to let everybody know what he's about.